Welcome to Gospel Tangents, the best source for Mormon history, science, and theology. I'm Rick Bennett. When Joseph Smith ran for president in 1844, he proposed gradual emancipation of slaves. In our next conversation with Dr. Derek Sainsbury, we'll talk about how that plan went over in the South. Hint, it didn't go very well. However, there were some surprising successes, so we'll talk about some of these successes and rough times the missionaries had in preaching for gradual emancipation in the South. Check out our conversation. Okay, so one of the interesting things about your book that I found was, I think most people are going to be interested in it because it's going to talk about Joseph Smith and the presidency, and you're going to get a lot of details on that that most people probably aren't familiar with. But I would say the second half of the book really covers after Joseph Smith. I like how you said how Brigham Young developed theodemocracy. He really did this idea of Joseph Smith that I think is based on Joseph Smith's views, General Joseph Smith's views. But let's talk a little bit more about some of these electioneer missionaries. I think the interesting thing for me, especially, I serve my mission in South Carolina, so I'm very familiar with Southern Baptists and Pentecostals and all sorts of things. But in 1844, slavery was legal, and Joseph Smith is talking about freeing the slaves. Don't think that went very well in the South.
It didn't. And we actually, the one blind spot that we have, or that I have as a historian with this, is none of the ones that went in the Deep South kept a journal.
Oh, really?
None of them. The closest we have is we know that some had passed through Tennessee on their way, or excuse me, through Kentucky on their way to Alabama. Some of the journals mention these guys that are headed there. And we know that there were some that, and we have a few newspaper accounts, but we don't have much. But the newspaper accounts are, you know, this is terrible. Now, we do have a lot of accounts in the Upper South, especially Kentucky and Tennessee. And it's really interesting because there's a dualistic dynamic there. There's very harsh pushback, and there's a lot of people accepting not just the gospel but the political views. It's really let me just give you a couple examples. George Miller is in Kentucky, and there's this Whig candidate speaking. In those days they had barbecues. They had these big barbecues.
They still have barbecues.
Right, but this is when it started. It was in the 40s, 1840, 1844. They'd have these huge barbecues and whiskey and, you know, get people to show up and listen. Well, he goes to the other end of the square and stands up on a tree trunk and starts...
The stump. That's what they actually call the stump.
That's right. And he starts preaching, and Joseph Smith, he's not preaching the gospel. He's doing electioneer stuff about General Joseph Smith's run for the presidency. And by the time he's done, the entire crowd is shifted and is listening to him. And when it's over, they say, you don't want any of this guy's barbecue. And they take him to the tavern and give him a big meal and stuff. And he writes about how many of them liked the ideas, even though some of them disliked, well, a lot of them disliked Joseph. And this was a common thread, not just in the Upper South, but everywhere.
What state was this in?
This was Kentucky.
Kentucky.
But even as far up as, you know, in Massachusetts and Boston, there were a lot of people that liked the ideas in the pamphlet, but not so much Joseph, right? And they would have these conferences where they would come up with these resolutions, for lack of a better word, and they were both Mormon and non-Mormon together. That agreed with these principles. And so there was more acceptance than we really knew. Not overwhelming, right? But there was some out there that were also didn't like the two-party system, didn't like the Democrats and the Whigs, were looking for another way forward.
A third way.
And they were starting to find some success among those groups. Now, in the Upper South, it's tricky though, right? Here's that same George Miller, you know, a couple days later is walking, and a guy stops him in the street and he says, "You best get out of here because my slaves have been told if they see you to lynch you, to put you up on the tree and lynch you. And so he's like, I'm moving on to the next town. In Kentucky, Abraham O. Smoot is responsible for the work, in Tennessee. He's responsible for the work in Tennessee. And he creates quite an impressive campaign machine, putting people in different counties. There's a lot of baptisms going on. There's some acceptance. He gets a printing contract for to print 1,000 copies of Joseph Smith's views. And when he comes back to get it, the guy has not printed it. There's a lawyer there who has sued to stop the printing of them because it calls for the abolition of slavery, which is against a Tennessee statute, right? And that event happens near the same time he holds a conference in Dresden. And during that conference, they're in a courthouse, okay? And this was actually the religious part of their conference. And a shot rings out, and bricks start coming through the courthouse windows. And they're like, ooh, you know, this is kind of a dangerous thing, right? And so they quickly dismiss and leave. They hold a meeting there about a week later that's religious and political. And this time they take hickory sticks with them into the courthouse. All of them have big hickory sticks. And there's a local couple in Dresden.
Kind of as a walking stick, kind of, but also a weapon?
A get back, yeah, exactly, as a get back stick, you know. A rascal beater, right? It gets used later in the assassination. But there's a local couple, we don't know their first names, last names were Camp, and they, that are members of the church and helping the electioneers. And they come with them to this meeting. Mr. Camp brings his shotgun, and Mrs. Camp brings herself, and I'll get to that in just a second. But they start this meeting, and in the middle of the meeting, 200 men come in and block the exits, and are just standing there menacing, waiting to, you know, to cause trouble. And one of them speaks up and says, you know, you're calling for the abolition of slavery, which Joseph technically wasn't calling for. He was calling for the purchase of slaves' freedom, not the release without reimbursement kind of idea, right?
But he still wanted to get them slaves.
To them it didn't matter, right? At least to those that had those very strong pro-slavery thoughts. And so, you know, he says, you can't do this. This is against the statutes. You guys need to get out of it, you know, in very rough language, obviously. And one of them steps to go towards Brother Smoot. And Mrs. Camp, 6 foot, 200 pounds.
She's a big woman.
Yells at the sheriff, who's Mr. Caldwell, Sheriff Caldwell, who's kind of in charge of this mob, and says, if you touch one of those elders, I will see your heart blood. It's an amazing story. And one of the other mob guys says, knock her down, you know. And the sheriff is just, for whatever reason, he turns around in his heart at that moment, for at least for this, and says, no one shall hurt you. No one shall hurt you, Mrs. Camp. And he allows them to leave. And so they pick up their hickory sticks and they walk out, Mrs. Camp in the lead, right? And walks them all out to safety. Well, meanwhile, out on the lawn, Mr. Camp with a shotgun has been kicking the lawyer that stood up and caused the ruckus. He's been kicking him around the lawn. And so it's just kind of a funny story that shows you how close a lot of them came to some very, I mean, some of them do get hurt. None of them are killed. Some are tarred and feathered. Some get shot at. Some are beaten up. One of the missionaries fakes being dead to get them to leave so that they stop beating him. You know, it's just, there's, and a lot of that violence, that kind of violence is happening in the upper South. So Virginia, Tennessee, Kentucky. where it's at the electioneers themselves, right? And so, yeah, the message is favorable in some areas, usually the poor, right, in the upper South, both politically and spiritually. But for the powers that be, these are for them dangerous men, and so there's definitely a fight back.
Mm-hmm. I hope you enjoyed our conversation with Dr. Derek Sainsbury. In our next conversation, I'll ask Dr. Sainsbury if there was any chance that Joseph Smith might have impacted the election results in 1844.
And so the only thing where I can see Joseph Smith's campaign affecting the general election at all would be if there had been enough converts, and that's where the majority of our missionaries, or the highest percentage of missionaries, go to New York. So if they had had more months to have more success in New York and created more converts and more political converts, there's a chance, a small chance, right, that they would have flipped enough votes away from the Democrats to then flip that state back to the Whigs, and then Henry Clay would have been elected.
Oh,
but again,
this is what year?
It's still 1844.
1844, okay.
But again, it's still...
So he could have been the Ralph Nader, right? Because
right.
Nader had the big problem in Florida.
Small chance.
With Gore and Bush.
Right, yeah. Small chance, though. Small chance that that actually happens.
If you'd like to hear the entire interview uncut, please subscribe to patreon.com/gospeltangents. And for just $5 a month, you can hear the entire interview without any interruption. If you'd like a paperback version of our transcripts, go to amazon.com and do a search for Gospel Tangents Interview. Also, if you'd like to give the money to me and not Amazon, please subscribe on my website, and I'll be able to send you a transcript as soon as they are completed, and click the subscribe button. You can also find our latest information on facebook.com/gospeltangents, as well as we're on Twitter @gospeltangents. And don't forget to subscribe on Apple Podcasts. The link is at tinyurl.com/gospeltangents, and you can subscribe there. Also, please give us a 5-star review. If you want to support all of the podcasts as part of the Dialogue Podcast Network, go to lyceum.fm, that's lyceum.fm, and do a search for Dialogue Podcast Network or Gospel Tangents, because, you know, that's a pretty cool one, too. Thanks again for listening. Click here to subscribe, here for a transcript, and over here we've got some of our great videos. Thanks again.